one. Okay. Ready whenever you are.
Right, well, you want me to start off with who I was?
Yes. Uh-huh.
My name is Ted Pick, or Edwin Pick, but I always hated Edwin, so I call myself Ted. I'm 96 years of age, and what else can I say about myself?
What age were you when you went to Arizona?
Ah, well, when I went to Arizona, I was 19. 19, because I volunteered for air crew when I was 17 and three quarters, and my mother went mad, and but I had to wait for quite a long time. But fortunately, I rushed through the initial training because I was in the ATC and I took proficiency part two examination. And that cut down my ITW to 1 month instead of 3 months. And if I hadn't passed that exam, I would have missed 25 course. But as it was, there was a hold up for training while we were waiting for training. And because they hadn't lost as many pilots as they expected in 1943-44, and so they slowed up the flying training program, and we had expected to do our flying training early in 44, and in actual fact we didn't do it until the end of 44 and didn't finish until the war ended in August 45. So we were disrupted by events, but
did you get your wings?
Oh yes, yeah, I got the wings in August 45, and June's husband Derek Stringer, he got his wings at the same time, and we then went off to New York on the way home, and we'd spent up with presents for taking home, and when we went into New York, I personally had $11 to go into New York for a long weekend, and I couldn't spend any money. Everybody thought I was a veteran come back from the Far East, and I couldn't spend any money. And I still got $4 when I got back into camp. I hadn't had much sleep, mind, but so it was a good time. And I never saw Derek again until we started with reunions. But that's a lot further on. We were sent out. We knew we were going to America to train. We didn't know where, and I knew there were four or five American flying training schools, and I fancied going to Arizona of all of them, and Arizona is where I went, and it was very fortunate that. We'd had a parcel of cadets who'd been together for nearly about 9 months or so, who knew each other very well, and we kept together in a clump, and most of us were selected to go to the same field, and then it was announced that we should go to Arizona, and then we had to. This was in Moncton, New Brunswick, that we went over to America on the Mauritania, and went by train to Moncton, New Brunswick, and it was absolutely freezing cold. It was in just after Christmas that we left, And so it was in December, we were in Moncton. And it was so cold that there were different buildings, and we had breakfast in one building and we lived in another building. And having had breakfast, you came out with half a cup of coffee to go back to the billet, and it was frozen by the time you got there. It was so cold. But then we travelled by train right across America, which took about 2 days, sleeping on the train, which was a very interesting experience. And eventually we arrived at Falcon Field, or we arrived at the station, Mesa Station. And I shall never forget, there was a very nonchalant cadet perched on a wagon at the side, and he'd been carried over from course 24, and he of course knew everything, and that was, his name was Whitehouse, Jeff Whitehouse, who was part of our course. And we were questioning him, of course, about how it all was. And we found it to be a very happy place, very happy. And we had, every week, we had exams to take. And if you didn't pass the exams, you didn't get out. But I got in out to Phoenix mostly every weekend. And the inhabitants of Phoenix and Mesa were wonderful to us and lent us their daughters and sent us on rides, on horse and cart rides. Out into the countryside, and they had this house in Phoenix that we could go and stay, and they looked after us tremendously well. And of course, we were learning to fly, which was absolutely terrific. Something we all wanted to do. We started with 100 in the course, and eventually I think 64 graduated. But my best friend in the Air Force, a fellow called Bob Wiseman, he was not very confident, and I used to give him a good chat every week that he was doing all right. And he was the last one to be washed out. And he was washed out when we were on advance, just got onto advance and started formation flying. And he just couldn't react fast enough. You had to tuck your wing right into behind the next plane. And of course you had to adjust your speed and your position automatically. There's no time to think. You had to be able to react to it, and he just never could. So unfortunately he was sent home, but he became my best friend always. But I did have one or two girlfriends there, but nothing permanent. And of course we all tried it on because we were all young men, and none of us had any chance. They were very well-behaved young ladies, all of them. And so we had a good time, a really good time, and a very healthy time. We had a swimming pool between the four blocks. There were four accommodation blocks. The course 25, and we had A, B, C and D I've forgotten what they're called. But I was in flights, yes, I was in sea flight. And in the middle of these four was this swimming pool, which had been put there by a film company because they had made a film of the training in Arizona at the time when American cadets were there as well. And in gratitude, the film company put this pool in, which was absolutely excellent because we loved getting into the pool. It's so hot all the time. The weather was colossal all the time, and you could see, you took off and you could see 100 miles. The air was so clear. I mean, I've been back since, and it's not like that anymore. You can still see about 60 miles, I suppose, but it has got gloomier. And of course, Mesa was almost on the edge of civilization then. And there was a junction, Apache Junction, which was up against Superstition Mountain. And people got lost and never came back from Superstition Mountain. And when I went back on a visit about 30 years ago, I hired a car and I got lost going to Apache Junction because I needed to go there to go off the direction I was going. And there's so much build up that I actually got lost. And the difference between when I was there training and when I went back all those years later was so terrific. But as I say, as well as our flying training, we did other things. We had we're shooting with shotguns at the pellets that were released, and we had to shoot them, and that was so that we learnt how to look in advance of where something was going to shoot it out of the sky. And so that was a useful training that was extra to what we did. And of course, we did a lot of PT early in the morning. And
real quick, can you hold that thought for just a sec? Try to slide this line just to the right.
That door moved.
Oh, that's okay. I'm going to close it a bit just so we don't get the birds as much and then no bugs come in.
Yes, we had one long cross country to do where we flew into Texas and back, and two of us went on that. And the fella I flew with was Jeff Whitehouse, and we flew off and stayed in Carlsbad in Texas, and we were there for VE Day. We were there, and we thought it was a miserable. We were all went into town. And I was asked, what did I think of it? Because people were driving around and tooting their horns. They weren't doing much else. And I said, you know, if we were back home, there'd be street parties going on and things would be tremendous. But at least they did celebrate VE Day there. And as I say, we flew back to Falcon, and the high spot of our training was the low flying cross country, which was about the last thing that we did. And of course, we were supposed to be at 250 feet, but in actual feet, we were going along dodging the cactus, the tall cactus that grow in Arizona. And that was absolutely marvellous, absolutely marvellous. And then we were presented with our wings and soon came home. And we were very sorry for 26, of course, who we were pretty certain would never finish. In actual fact, I think they stayed for about 6 weeks or something like that before they too came home. But it was a wonderful experience for a young man. I mean, I had virtually never been out of the country, never been anywhere, because I came from I didn't come from a poor family, but I came from a family where my father was a gambler and had lost all his money, and we struggled badly. And so life was very hard when I was a young man, but I managed to get myself a good education. But although I had to leave school when I was 15 and a half, as soon as I matriculated, I couldn't go on for any higher because they needed me out of work earning the money. So that was a bit of a hardship. But I've survived and had a good life, so I've got nothing to complain about. And of course, I met June with her husband on many reunions, and her husband, he ran a number of mini reunions just for 25 course, as well as the main reunions. They were with a lot of people, but 25 course, we generally had about 40 people turn up, and they were good seeing all our old friends. And that's when I first met June, and then all the reunions finished. And I didn't see her anymore because I live in Staffordshire and she lived in Hertfordshire. So I didn't see her anymore, and we kept in touch by email and phone just occasionally when we needed to say something about the association. And so life went on. My wife died, and I started to go on cruises because she would never go on cruises. And I went on a world cruise at the beginning of 2016. And it was around the world for 110 days. And I loved it during the day, but going back to the cabin at night, it was utterly miserable, utterly miserable. So when I was back, about a couple of months after I was back, June phoned me because she'd lost touch with one of the ex-cadets. And so I looked into that and phoned her back. And then I plucked up the courage, because I was 90 then, and I plucked up my courage and said, I've got a cruise booked with the double cabin. Any chance you would join me? And she thought about it for half a minute perhaps, and then she said, no, I'm sorry, I don't think I could do that, which was no surprise to me, because I thought, if I ask a woman to join me on a cruise, she'll think that at 90, I'm looking for someone to look after me in my old age, because I was very active still at 90. So anyway, she said no, and I said, well, fair enough, you know, and rang off. But luckily, her daughter was with her while this telephone was going on. And her daughter really tore off a strip, said, what's the matter with your mother? She said, you're lonely, you're miserable, and you know this fella, and he asked you to go on a cruise. what's the matter with you? And June said, well, I don't know him. And, you know, she didn't, because we'd just met as married couples. And her daughter insisted that she phone me back, which she did. So I said, of course, you know, glad for you to phone me back, thank you very much. But we both got cold feet. We thought, well, we don't know each other. And we haven't seen each other for 23 years. And so I said, well, I'll book a hotel in Norfolk, and we'll have a week sharing a room and see how we get on. So she agreed, and I said, well, I'll come and... So I fixed it all up, and I said, well, I'll come and pick you up on the Friday and on the Saturday morning and carry on up to... She said, no, you won't. She said, you can't drive all that way. She said, you'll come and stay the night, the Friday before. So I said, all right then, thank you very much. So I drove there, and I was relying on my sat-nav, and the sat-nav said I was nearly there, and I phoned her and said, I'll be with you in half an hour. And I was with her in 10 minutes. And when I rang the bell, she'd just been finishing up the meal that she was getting ready. She'd got her curlers in and her dressing gown, and her foot was on the stairs to go up and get ready. And so reluctantly, she came to the door in her curlers. And I just fell about laughing. And I thought, poor girl, she'll be so embarrassed. So I was going to take things very, very easy, but instead I just went across the threshold and grabbed her and gave her a big hug. And we found we were kissing almost immediately, and we just fell in love instantly. And it's been like it ever since. And I was 90 and she was 84. And life's been wonderful ever since. We've been on cruises, we've had a wonderful time in our old age. So it's never too late, never too late. So I don't know what else you would like to hear.
That's a beautiful story, by the way. It's beautiful. It's really lovely.
Yes.
When you were in Arizona, was there any food that you particularly liked? Does the food stand out to you?
Well, I suppose I liked Coca-Cola. We hadn't had Coca-Cola. And I liked their hamburgers. I liked them. And...
Did you ever have any of the oranges?
Oh, yes, all the fruit. The fruit was marvellous, yes. Absolutely marvellous.
And then, you know, this is a really weird question, but did you ever go to church?
To church? No, I didn't go to church. I was confirmed, but I was confirmed when I went to the ITW. There was the pastor there was a tremendous fella, and he persuaded me to be confirmed, and I was confirmed and then lapsed almost straight away once that. So I didn't go to church, but I do go to church now. I'm a regular, and so I suppose all my late life I've been very regular and supported the church and support charities well, because it's the right thing to do. And I came to it fairly late in life, I suppose. But,
the reason I was asking was because somebody had been to a church, and I'm trying to work out what church it was. That's why I was
wondering. I don't
if
know.
Had ever been.
I think we did go to church for a service, But I didn't go to church independently, no.
And then did you ever fly again after the war?
Well, I did fly again when we had reunions, one or two reunions were, the mini reunions were organised where we could have flights, and we went on flights then, and I was amazed to find that I could still fly just as well as I ever could. And indeed, when I was 75 here, I went with a party to the gliding school and went up with a pilot taking me, and he handed over to me as soon as we got at the top, and he was absolutely amazed. He said, "You'll have trouble when you turn, because you'll yaw, but don't worry about it." But in actual fact, I flew round gliding, and he'd put a bit of telltale cotton or wool on the windscreen. And he said it never moved. He couldn't believe how well I was flying. And that was when I was 75 and had only just done an occasional one. And I thought to myself, oh, well, perhaps I'll take up this gliding, because I'd always fancied it, but I didn't want to leave my family, you see, and because I had two children and they were more important than me going gliding. So, but as I say, I was 75 and I thought I might take this up. And then I thought, silly old fool, you can hardly get in and out to the glider, so you can't possibly do it. And so I never did. But I would have loved to have carried on gliding or done gliding, because I always loved flying. But while I had my family and bringing up the children, there was never any spare money to, we were buying the house and supporting the children, and there was never any spare money we didn't even have any spare money to have hotel holidays. We used to go camping holidays. We went abroad with the kids and eventually got a caravan and went abroad, but we never stayed in hotels. We couldn't afford to. But we had a good life. We had a good life.
And then you had said you returned to Arizona. How many times did you go back to Arizona?
I only went back. Went back the once, and that was after my wife had died. That again was 2015, I think it was. A friend in Texas said, my wife had died, and he said, come and stay with us. So I arranged to go and stay with them for a couple of weeks, and I've got relatives in Vancouver that I've never seen, so I arranged to go and stay with them for a couple of weeks. And then the charity came up and offered to send me to Arizona. So I accepted their offer and had 2 days in Arizona in between the two places. The only unfortunate thing was that we got there on American Independence Day, and so everything was closed. But we did manage to have a look round. I say we because my son-in-law came with me. The charity insisted that I had a helper, because I was coming up to 90, and so he had a week out of it as well, and we hired a car and drove round as well, and stayed a couple of nights near the airfield, but we never got to see the airfield open. But that was that, and
now, were you thinking about going to the reunion?
Oh, when I say no, I did go over separately when I was about 80. Of course I did. My wife wouldn't go because it was too hot in Arizona. She wouldn't go. And so I went for a month and had a fortnight. It was the 50th anniversary of opening of the field when I went. And yes, so I did go then, and I hired a car and went up to the Grand Canyon as well and back. And then went on to and met my relatives in Arizona, in Vancouver, for the first time. That, yes, of course, so I went twice. I went back twice to Falcon.
Now, when you were in Falcon Field, did you ever take any side trips? Did you ever, a lot of people seem to have gone to Hollywood or any of that?
Yeah, well, we had two leaves. The first leave, three of my friend Bob and another couple of lads joined Sergeant Holmes, who was the armaments instructor. He was English, and he got a car, and so he took us. He wanted to see all the sights, the painted desert and the cowboy towns and things like that. So we went with him for that, and his car broke down halfway round, and so we left him behind and hitchhiked was that week? Was it? No, it wasn't that time. No, we stayed with him, and we went all round the sites near to Mesa, but we stayed away. And we went up to the Grand Canyon and stayed the night at the top of the Grand Canyon and walked down and had a night in Phantom Ranch at the bottom of the canyon, which was, it was about 9 miles down, and a beautiful place, absolutely beautiful place, and it's still a beautiful place because there's no traffic allowed down there. You still have to go down by mule, and but we walked down because we couldn't afford to go down by mule. We walked down and stayed the night there, and coming back, poor old Sergeant Holmes was an old man. He was 32, I think. And coming back up, it was a 9.5 miles walk up the other trail. We went down one trail and came back up the Bright Angel Trail. And we got our hands in Sergeant Holmes's back, and we were pushing him up because he was just failing. And we all got back safely. And he carried on driving us for the rest of the time. But the second leave we had, we went to Hollywood, and Sergeant Holmes again took us, and his car broke down halfway there, and so I've still got the garage's card, which had got, there, I can't remember what was on it, but it was a funny, it was a humorous title on it. But anyway, so his broke down and he was going to be there for 2 days while they were doing his car. So we just had to leave him and we hitchhiked to Hollywood. And we had difficulty there because a lady picked us up and she wasn't going to Hollywood. She was going across the country somewhere. And we left her at a suitable crossroads and she went off. But we eventually got there and had a very good time. We were looked after very well there. Bob and I were given accommodation by a couple of English ladies who'd retired there, and I did meet a girl there that I really fell for. She was at University of Los Angeles, and I went to her presentation of her certificate, and as I say, I was very close to her, but I never got back there. I couldn't afford, as I say, I was poor as a church mouse and couldn't afford to go. And we did keep in touch for a while, and she sent a couple of parcels over, but it all fell apart eventually. And that was that. But yes, we saw a lot of film stars at the time, and went to some big houses, and had a wonderful week's leave in Hollywood, and saw all the Hollywood sights. It was very fortunate, as I say, as a young man, I had never been abroad before, except when I was very young, before my father gambled all his money away. We did go to Blankenberg for a week. But I was about 4 or 5 and remember hardly anything about it. But so, as I say, it was all wonderful for me because it was all completely fresh and new. And so I was very grateful to the Air Force for sending me over there.
Were you thinking of going to the reunion, this up-and-coming reunion?
Well, we were thinking we might, but
nobody can go now anyway.
With so. June's accident,
oh, yes.
I don't think we shall be able to go. Mm-hmm. And
but what, if you could, what would you say is a message that you would send to them?
Well, I'd like to thank the people of Mesa and Phoenix for the wonderful way they looked after us when we were there in 1944-45. Well, we were there 45, I suppose. Hardly there much 44 at all. We just arrived in January, I think. We weren't there for Christmas. So yes, that would be the message I would say. What wonderful people they were. And what wonderful people I found Americans to be in their own country. They are wonderful people. Very outgoing and easy to talk to and accepting other people.
Were you assigned to a particular family?
No.
Oh.
No, I wasn't. When we went to Hollywood, there were one or two people who were lent daughters for the for the week they were there, and daughters had got cars to drive around in, and so drove them about. But it wasn't Bob Wiseman who was with me then, because he'd been washed out before then, but it was Sid. Very good friend of mine. I've forgotten his surname now.
That's
okay. Sid, yes. But...
Well, are there any questions I'm not thinking of, Vince? What have I not included?
I think we've got a lot of it covered. Went through quite a bit.
I'm sure there's things I should have told you, which...
Is there anything else you can think of? Oh, I know. Do you have any specific memories about the planes you flew?
Well, they were Stearman biplanes, which were wonderfully easy to fly. Wonderfully easy to fly. In fact, they were so easy to fly that, and I was so good at it that a couple of times when I was supposed to be doing dual at night, my instructor stayed by the flare pots playing cards while I did the dual trips. And so that when I got on to Harvard's, I found difficult, because you sit right at the front of the Harvard and there's no aircraft in front of you, and I found it difficult, and I wondered whether I was going to make it, in point of fact, and because my instructor, I mean, I got on ever so well with him, and I stayed friends with him all our lives. But he was a very shouty individual, and he shouted at me, and I didn't react well to that. And I wondered whether I was going to make it. And in actual fact, I think it was 7 hours on the Harvard before I was taken. He passed me over to another senior instructor to take me up and check me out, and he sent me solo, and after that I was all right, but it was very worrying at the time, to say, I got on ever so well with Fred Murha. After that we sort of settled down, and I always made decisions. I never waited to be told to do things, and so we got on very well, and I love the Harvards. Wonderful planes, wonderful. So those are my only memories of the planes. What fun it was to fly them. And I remember the first night solo that they did. It was about an hour. I had to fly up the valley and back, and it was absolutely wonderful to be there in the dark, flying along there with the valley, all the lights below. It was a wonderful experience, that first solo night flight. I mean, my first solo flight on the Stearman was a wonderful experience. I whooped for joy when I took off and was on my own for the first time in an aeroplane. It was just absolutely marvellous, marvellous.
When you look back on it now, do you think it's quite unbelievable how you were so young? And how do you think that did those experiences help you in your life going forward?
Oh, tremendously, because I wasn't concerned about the responsibility. I knew I could do it, and although I was so young, I had no problems with the responsibility, and I knew that I was a very good pilot because, I didn't know at the time. I thought I was a good pilot, but when I was being discharged, I was stuck near to the headquarters of records. They'd lost my documents, and I persuaded the station to let me go and find my documents. So I went there, and of course I went here and was sent there, and one place a WAF walked across the floor, opened a filing box, got my documents out, and she didn't seal the envelope up very well. So on the way back I was able to read the documents, and I found that I came third in ground studies in the final exams, and I came fifth or sixth in the flying exams out of the 65 of us who graduated. So I was very pleased about that, but I only found it out, as I say, just as I was leaving the Air Force.
Very good.
Yes.
Very good.
Yes. So.
So what do you think, Vince?
That's good. Oh, very well.
Is there anything else you can think of, sir?
Well, I'm sure there's lots of things I ought to be able to think of, but it's all so long ago now.
Right. I'm surprised you can remember as much as you do.
I mean, it's, as I say, it's, it was 45, and I was just 20. I was 20 when I got my wings. I was just 20. So it's 76 years ago.
Quite a while.
Yes. So it's not surprising, I suppose. It's remarkable that, and of course, the other thing was that I've looked young all my life. I mean, people don't believe that I'm 96 now, and I have a job to believe it as well. But when I was young, I looked very young. I looked about 14 when I was started in the Air Force, and I think it's because of my youth that I didn't get commissioned, and it's the reason why as soon as hair started to grow on my face, I grew a moustache, and I've never not had a moustache ever since, but it's just became a habit, and I kept it on because I look so young. And when I was young, it was very difficult because girls really wouldn't take me seriously, but since I've become old, it's been a great boon.
Very good advantage.
Yes, that's right. Yes. Yes.
Do you think June would like to speak or not?
Would you like to speak, June? June.
Yeah, I know.
she doesn't know if she wants to or not. You don't have to, June. No. I just didn't know whether...
Mini reunions, because the main reunions are every 3 years. And the members of 65 who we met, a member of 25, of course, who we saw at the reunions, all would like to have seen each other more often. And Derek was volunteered to do the reunion. So he did several mini reunions, about half a dozen. And the last reunion, June did on her own, because Derek had died, and at his funeral, you know, the fellows were going to say, what are we going to do about the reunion? And June said, well, she would do it, and she organised it, and we all had a week in Menorca.
You organised something fun then, June.
Yes, that's right. Well, June's got a little holiday cottage there, more or less, and which she's had since her father died. Her father left it to her, and so she thought it would be nice for us all, so she organised it in Menorca. And so there are about 25 or 30 of us went to Menorca, yes, with our wives, yes, didn't we?
And one thing that Rose said, I thought, you know, our book up. And they said, well, you're stopping your little place. I said, no, it's silly. Well, they said, why, you know, walk into a hotel? No, you go and stay in your house, but you can come over every morning. And well, you know, some of them had cars, and I sort of told them where to go. But I used to make a journey every morning, only a mile, just too far to walk every morning. But it was pretty good. But small.
Right. Oh, but that was fun though.
Oh,
that was fun.
It was fun.
Okay, well, excellent. Well, what we'll do then now is we'll get pictures of some of the